Highbridge, a division of Recorded Books, presents Crossings, How Road Ecology is Shaping the Future of Our Planet, by Ben Goldfarb. Read by Malcolm Hillgartner. Introduction. The Wing of the Swallow. If you've ever driven across the United States of America, you have passed beneath the wings of a plucky songbird, smaller than your palm, light as your pocket change, feathered in jaunty blue and umber, called the cliff swallow. Where other animals flee the human footprint, cliff swallows shelter in its tread. Petrochelidon pyranota should properly be called the bridge swallow, for our steel spans have furnished it with more nesting sites than bluffs and canyons ever did. Once a bird of the western mountains, in the last century, cliff swallows have spread onto the Great Plains and across them, plastering their gourd-shaped mud nests to girders and trusses, feats of avian engineering no less impressive than our own viaducts. Once the environment is ruined, a biologist named Charles Brown told me, all we'll have left is rats, cockroaches, and cliff swallows. Cliff swallows are gregarious birds whose colonies can number in the thousands. Like most civilizations, theirs are messy. They steal nests, bully others into mating, fight so viciously that they sometimes tumble into rivers and drown. For the last four decades, Brown has paid annual visits to more than 200 nesting sites in Nebraska, trying to figure out what makes swallow societies thrive or fail. He has studied how well they catch insects, how they spread diseases, how they fend off snakes. He has captured more than 400,000 swallows in nets and encircled more than 200,000 slender legs with coated metal bracelets. Mostly what he has done is drive, more miles than he can hazard, from bridge to bridge, colony to colony. 98% of cliff swallows in western Nebraska, Brown said, are going to be within 50 feet of a road. Near a road, of course, is the most dangerous place an animal can live, and swallows, for all their agility, occasionally fall victim to passing cars and trucks. When Brown and his longtime collaborator, the ornithologist Mary Bomberger Brown, began studying swallows in the 1980s, they picked up these casualties, wings broken and heads crushed, and brought them to their lab. They dressed the bodies, replacing eyes and viscera with cotton, lacing up feathered breasts like shoes, and tucked them in a drawer. They didn't have any plan for the birds. It just seemed proper. The waste of death diminished by the salvage of data. Years passed. The number of publications mounted. The swallows flourished. In 2012, a new assistant asked Brown to teach him the art of dressing birds. Brown promised there would be plenty of roadkill on which to practice. When summer arrived, though, there was virtually no roadkill to be found, just empty asphalt and swallows gloriously alive, taunting the vehicles below. The epiphany hit Brown like an 18-wheeler. This was not a single summer fluke. Swallow roadkill had been dwindling for years. He'd collected 20 dead birds in 1984 when the project began, and 20 more in 1985 and 1986. Then the trend line slanted downward, straight as a ski slope. 15 in 1989, 13 in 1991, 8 in 2002. By 2011, the toll had dropped to 4. Brown considered various explanations, then dismissed them. There weren't fewer swallows to be whacked, or more vultures bearing away carcasses, nor was there less traveling on his part. No, Brown thought. Somehow, swallows had become harder to kill. He found his answer in the corpses themselves. When he stretched a tape measure from the birds' shoulders to their outermost feathers, he found that car-struck swallows had longer wings than the average bird he snared in his nets. The difference was slight, no more than a few millimeters, but the gap had unmistakably grown over the years. Brown immediately understood the significance. Long wings were good for straight, lengthy flights, between nests and feeding grounds, for example. Shorter wings were better for maneuverability, for performing the tight pivots and rolls with which a swallow would evade a falcon, or a flatbed hauling a load of lumber to Omaha. traffic was weeding clumsier, long-winged swallows from the population and favoring their nimbler, short-winged flockmates. It was Darwinian selection in action, so clean and rapid it belonged in a textbook. Morphologically, these are not the same birds anymore, Brown said. But it seemed to me they were also different in some deeper, more metaphysical sense. Centuries ago, before we paved North America, cliff swallows had existed largely beyond human influence. Now they were so enmeshed in our world that our infrastructure had infiltrated their DNA. Cliff swallows were a success story, rare beneficiaries of concrete and steel. Yet their triumph had come at a cost to the long-winged martyrs culled from the population and to the birds' altered genes themselves. Cliff swallows had survived, but as a changed thing. They had been shaped, subtly but intimately, by the road. When alien archaeologists exhume the rubble of human civilization, they may conclude that our raison d'etre was building roads. Some 40 million miles of roadways encircle the Earth, from the continent-spanning Pan-American Highway to the 100,000 miles of illegal logging routes that filigree the Amazon. Our planet is burdened by 3,000 tons of infrastructure for every human, nearly a third of an Eiffel Tower per person. Roads predate the wheel. Mesopotamian builders began laying mud brick paths in 4000 BCE, centuries before anyone thought to drop a chariot onto a couple of potter's discs. Today it's impossible to imagine life without the asphalt arteries that connect goods with markets, employees with jobs, families with each other. Everything in life is somewhere else, wrote E.B. White, and you get there in a car. Roads are both logistical essentials and cultural artifacts. They epitomize freedom, the architecture of our restlessness, per Rebecca Solnit, the two lanes that take us anywhere, per Bruce Springsteen. To us, roads signify connection and escape. To other life forms, they spell death and division. Sometime during the 20th century, scientists have written, roadkill surpassed hunting as the leading direct human cause of vertebrate mortality on land. Name your environmental ill, dams, poaching, megafires, and consider that roads kill more creatures with less fanfare than any of them. More birds die on American roads every week than were slain by the Deepwater Horizon oil spill, with the road deaths accompanied by a fraction of the hand-wringing. And it's only getting worse as traffic swells. A half century ago, just 3% of land-dwelling mammals met their end on a road. By 2017, the toll had quadrupled. It has never been more dangerous to set paw, hoof, or scaly belly on the highway. Roads distort the planet in other, more insidious ways. No sooner was Rome's Via Cassia completed around 100 BCE, than its surface began to shed sediment into Lago di Monterosi, spawning algal blooms that permanently distorted the lake's ecosystem. Phytophthora lateralis, an invasive fungus that attacks cedar trees, hitchhikes in the patterns of truck tires. The little red fire ant, a merciless insect, notorious for stinging the eyes of elephants, has exploited logging tracks to spread through Gabon 60 times faster than it would have otherwise. Pavement itself blankets less than 1% of the United States, yet its influence, the road effect zone, to use ecological jargon, covers a full 20%. Park your car in the shoulder and bushwhack half a mile into the woods, and you'll still see fewer birds than you would in an unroaded wilderness. Hike 2 miles more, and you'll still see fewer mammals. If you're a Kerouac reader, you grew up steeped in the dogma that highways represent freedom. If you're a grizzly bear, they might as well be prison walls. The repercussions of roads are so complex that it's hard to pinpoint where they end. British Columbia's caribou herds have dwindled to furtive bands, in part because logging and mining roads have permitted the ingress of wolves, a human-caused disaster disguised as natural predation. Nearly a fifth of America's greenhouse gas emissions are coughed out by cars and trucks, and the transportation sector is the fastest-growing contributor to climate change. Meanwhile, the rise of electric vehicles, whose batteries depend on lithium and other metals, has catalyzed a mining boom that threatens to disfigure landscapes in places as disparate as Chile, Zimbabwe, and Nevada. Even habitat loss, the most thorough eraser of wildlife, is a road problem. Before you can log Alaska's rainforests or convert Bornean jungles into oil palm monocultures, you need roads to transport the machinery in and the product out. Roads are, you might say, the roots of all evil. Yet roads select winners as well as losers. Arizona's highways funnel rainfall into ditches and thus soften desert soils for pocket gophers, whose tunnels parallel the shoulder like subway lines. Vultures, ravens, and other cunning scavengers are ascendant, their diets subsidized by roadkill. Butterflies, whose prairies have been devoured by cornfields, find succor in unkempt strips of roadside milkweed. In Britain, such habitat is called the soft estate, a suggestion that roads are capable of creating new ecosystems, even as they shatter existing ones. A biologist once led me beneath a highway bridge to show me hundreds of little brown bats roosting in its crevices, seemingly unbothered by the traffic thumping overhead. Considering the outsized effects of roads, it's perhaps surprising that they didn't truly receive their scientific due until the late 20th century. One afternoon in 1993, a landscape ecologist named Richard Foreman was standing in his Harvard office with a few students, admiring a satellite photograph of a forest. Foreman was expounding on the forest's features, where the water flowed, why people had put houses where they had, how the animals moved through it, when he paused. "I noticed the long slice going diagonally across the image," he recalled to me. "It was a two-lane road through the forest. I said, gee, we know a lot about the ecology of everything else in this image, but we don't know much about the ecology of that." Inspired by inattention, Foreman soon coined an English term, road ecology, defined loosely as the study of how life changes for plants and animals with a road and traffic nearby. Footnote. As European road ecologists are quick to remind their American colleagues, road ecology was actually a translation of Straßenökologie, a neologism coined by a German scientist named Heinz Ellenberg in 1981. End footnote. He did not immediately attract disciples. When a major government committee invited Foreman to present his new field to transportation higher-ups the next year, he was met with polite laughter. "You're not here to make us stop running over animals, are you?" one engineer asked, cocking an eyebrow. As the 1990s wore on, though, road ecology gained steam. Foreman and other pioneers published papers, wrote textbooks, held conferences that lured curious officials. "All of a sudden," Foreman said, "it became mainstream." My own introduction to road ecology came in 2013, the year I embarked on a trip across the continent to write about an extraordinary scheme called the Yellowstone to Yukon Conservation Initiative. The goal of Yellowstone to Yukon, or Y2Y, is boggling. Its advocates envision a network of connected habitats that would permit animals to wander unhindered along the spine of the Rockies, a region that spans five American states and four Canadian provinces and territories. Such a corridor would preserve migration routes for elk and caribou, permit far-ranging creatures such as wolves to mingle and mate, and help sensitive animals like wolverines flee northward as climate change nips at their heels. The initiative's emblem is the grizzly, whose expansive requirements make it a useful proxy for other forms of life. An ecosystem that can support bears is probably healthy enough for everyone else. To the uninitiated, it sounded far-fetched. Soon after Y2Y's inception, the West Wing parodied it as the wolves-only roadway, the vanity project of humorless tree huggers who get laughed out of the White House. But the show's writers, like most of Y2Y's critics, misunderstood the concept. Y2Y wasn't a discrete pathway. It was a continental jigsaw riddled with missing pieces, most of them at the fragile margins where wildlands and settlements collided. The mission of Y2Y and its many partners was to plug those holes, to help bears and other animals safely navigate the Rockies without running afoul of humans. In British Columbia, I toured protected grain fields that grizzlies use to commute between mountain ranges at night. In Montana, I sniffed offal in an electric-fenced paddock where ranchers were composting their dead cows rather than permitting them to fester in bear-enticing boneyards. Few travelers, human or ursine, can resist fast food. Yet Y2Y's deepest cuts remained mostly unhealed. The region was riven by enough numbered roads to fill a Sudoku puzzle. I-90 and Highway 3 and Highway 20, Routes 95 and 40 and 12 and 212, spider-webbed otherwise wild lands. I drove highways that ended lives. I lost track of how many elk littered the shoulder on Crow's Nest Pass, and others that cleaved grizzly populations into lonely clusters. Roads, I began to realize, were not merely a symptom of civilization, but a distinct disease. Among the roads within the Y2Y corridor's ambit was US 93, which traverses Montana on its 1,300-mile jaunt from Arizona to the Canadian border. Like so many highways, US 93 had been built heedlessly in the 1950s, plowing through wetlands, elk meadows, and a vast reservation belonging to the Confederated Salish and Kootenai tribes. When, in the 1990s, state and federal agencies sought to expand US 93 from two lanes to four, tribal officials demanded the chance to provide input on the reconstruction. A wider, faster road might be safer for drivers, but it would also slaughter more deer, elk, bears, and other animals foundational to the tribe's culture. The road is a visitor, the tribes insisted, that should respond to and be respectful of the land and the spirit of place. The Salish and Kootenai flexed their legal and moral muscles, and when US 93 was finally reconstructed, engineers included around 40 wildlife crossings, a network of underpasses, tunnels, and culverts that allowed animals to slink beneath the highway unimpeded. Roadside fencing kept creatures off the highway and guided them toward the passages. The project's flagship structure was an elegant bridge designed principally for that avatar of wildness, the grizzly bear. In aerial photos, the overpass looked at once futuristic and anachronistic, a green parabola that vaulted over the highway with Middle Earthish grace. If roads were a disease, wildlife crossings seemed like a treatment. That October, I drove US 93 in the company of Marcel Hauscher, a lean, grizzled road ecologist who had begun studying the highway back when the crossings were still in their planning stages. I was then more or less ignorant of road ecology, let alone how one became a road ecologist. So, as we headed north from Missoula, I asked Hauscher to tell me about his past. He'd grown up in the Netherlands, a country that packs one of the world's densest road networks into a landmass one-ninth the size of Montana. Bears and wolves had long since fled the overbuilt Dutch landscape, so Hauscher had studied hedgehogs, which popped in and out of gardens like cheerful neighbors. "Everybody thinks they're cute and wonderful," Hauscher said as we rolled past golden cottonwood galleries. "They're a very sympathetic animal. People want to make things pleasant for hedgehogs." Alas, hedgehogs, small, plodding, nocturnal, were practically designed to be roadkill, and Hauscher's calculations suggested that hundreds of thousands were being crushed each year. This was a familiar story in the Netherlands. Roads, dikes, canals, and towns had broken the country's landscape into pieces, leaving little space for hedgehogs and other fauna. In 1990, the country, with typical Dutch ingenuity, had launched a national defragmentation plan that ultimately led to the construction of more than 800 wildlife crossings on national highways, from badger pipes to deer bridges. Hauscher's research had shown that hedgehogs prefer the ecotones, where forests and grasslands meet, helping planners situate new passages. "One of my statements during my PhD defense was that they're really edgehogs," he said, sheepish at the pun. In 1998, Hauscher met his wife, an American conservationist named Bethany Walder, at, what else, a road conference. He eventually relocated to Montana to work for the Western Transportation Institute, the research team tasked with studying the U.S. 93 crossings. In the years that followed, Hauser and his colleagues scooped up deer pellets, pored over photos snapped by motion-activated cameras, and crouched to inspect hoof and paw prints deposited in sandy soil. By the time I visited, animal collisions had fallen by around three-quarters, and Hauser's team had documented tens of thousands of successful traversals through the crossings. Coyotes, foxes, bobcats, elk, otters, porcupines, moose, grizzlies. Highway 93, Hauser told me, compares favorably with anywhere else in the world in the number and density of structures, even the Netherlands. As Hauser parked beside the overpass, dusk descended. He unlocked a gate in the roadside fence, and we slipped through as though into a portal, passing from the world of the highway to a wild, parallel dimension. We climbed the gentle slope, autumn grass crispy beneath our boots. I reached the crossing's apex and peered down at the muffled stream of Missoula-bound traffic. The horizon glowed orange. The evening was sharp with oncoming winter. Though we were just three stories above the earth, I felt buoyant. The air shimmered with supernatural possibility. At any moment, I thought, a grizzly would emerge from the pines and trudge onto the bridge. Hauser didn't share my muted awe. He paced the crossing and pointed out design flaws. He was displeased with the bridge's Spartan landscaping. A few carefully positioned brush piles, he suspected, would aid mice and voles. And its sightlines were too exposed. His cameras had recently captured a black bear fleeing the headlights of an approaching car. A visual screen would be helpful, he said. Shrubbery or an earthen berm might do the trick. It could just be a wooden fence. Hauser, it occurred to me, was attempting to inhabit other beings' Umwelt, their subjective lived experience. Road ecology was an act of interspecies imagination, a field whose radical premise asserted that it was possible to perceive our built world through non-human eyes. How does a moose comprehend traffic? What sort of tunnel appeals to a mink? Why do grizzly bears prefer crossing over highways while black bears go under? These questions had empirical answers, but they also required ecologists to think like wild animals. Empathy manifested as science. To us, roads are so mundane they're practically invisible. To wildlife, they're utterly alien. Other species perceive the world through senses we cannot fathom and experience stressors and enticements we hardly register. Bats are lured astray by streetlights. Snails desiccate as they slog across deserts of asphalt, and seabirds crash land on the shiny tarmac they mistake for the ocean. Consider the sensory experience of, say, a fox approaching a highway. The eerie linear clearing that gashes the landscape. The acrid stench of tar and blood. The blinding lights staring from the faces of thundering predators. When Hazel, the rabbit protagonist of Watership Down, encounters his first road, he confuses it for a river. Black, smooth, and straight between its banks. A passing car fills the whole world with noise and fear. Now that I've learnt about it, he adds, I want to get away from it as soon as I can. Road ecology inverts our oldest joke about animals and transportation. Why did the chicken cross the road? Embedded in that chestnut is an assumption that the road is inviolable and eternal, as fixed in its course as a river. The road is a given. It's the fowl whose actions demand explanation. But the riddle's logic is backward. It's the animals who have always moved, the road that's the upstart. A better question might be, why did the road cross the land? This framing isn't always comfortable. When we don't ignore roads, we dismiss their toll as the inevitable cost of modernity. Other forms of human-caused animal death are deliberate. We pull the trigger, set the trap, order the cheeseburger. But few among us ever flatten an animal on purpose. Like most people, I at once cherish animals and think nothing of piloting a 3,000-pound death machine. The allure of the car is so strong that it has persuaded Americans to treat 40,000 human lives as expendable each year. What chance does wildlife have? One summer in Alaska, I hit a feisty songbird called a yellow-rumped warbler, a death I didn't discover until I found the delicate splash of feathers wedged in the grill the next day. I'd killed not with malice, but with mobility. We treat the attrition of lives on the road like the attrition of lives in war, the writer Barry Lopez lamented. Horrifying, unavoidable, justified. This is particularly true in the United States, home to the world's longest road network at 4 million miles. Our mid-century automotive revolution spawned not only highways, but also parking lots, driveways, suburbs, pipelines, gas stations, car washes, drive-throughs, tire shops, and strip malls. A totalizing ecosystem engineered for its dominant organism, the car. For all its grandeur, though, America's highway network is relatively static. Although we spend almost $200 billion on our roads annually, most goes toward repair rather than new construction. Granted, American wildlands are hardly safe from ill-conceived development. Florida, for one, has been scheming up new toll roads in panther habitat, and even routine highway maintenance projects have an uncanny knack for adding lanes and worsening traffic. Even so, our country's asphalt limbs have mostly ceased to elongate, petrified into something like their eternal shape. Instead, we're exporting our autocentric lifestyle. More than 25 million miles of new road lanes will be built worldwide by 2050, many through the world's remaining intact habitats, a concrete wave that the ecologist William Lawrence has described as an infrastructure tsunami. Astoundingly, as of 2016, 3/4 of the infrastructure that will exist by the middle of this century had yet to be built. Although it's easy to denounce the tsunami, I benefit from roads as much as anyone. I eat avocados trucked from California. I get pizza delivered to my doorstep. I rely on America's marvel of a highway system to reach friends and hospitals and airports. And I confess to feeling what one Volkswagen ad campaign called Fahrvergnügen, the pleasure of driving. Roads pose the same queasy conundrum as climate change. Having profited wildly from growth, can wealthy nations deny less developed countries the benefits of connectivity? Road ecology offers one path through this thicket. North America and Europe constructed their road networks with little regard for how they would affect nature, and even less comprehension of how to blunt those effects. Today, in theory, we know better. Road ecology has revealed the perils of reckless development and pointed us toward solutions. Over the last several decades, its practitioners have constructed bridges for bears, tunnels for turtles, rope webs that allow howler monkeys to swing over highways without descending to the forest floor. On Christmas Island, red crabs clamber over a steel span during their beachward migrations. In Kenya, elephants lumber beneath highways and railroads via passages as tall as 2-story houses. And road ecology has yielded more than crossings. We've also learned to map and protect the migrations of cryptic animals, to design roadsides that nourish bees and butterflies, and to deconstruct the derelict logging tracks that lace our forests, proof that old mistakes need not be permanent. Quoth the late-night sage John Oliver, "Infrastructure isn't sexy." Clearly, he hasn't talked to a road ecologist. Roads have become one of conservation's most urgent topics, the focus of hundreds of scientists operating in dozens of countries. Over several years, I traveled the world meeting some of them. The biologists tracking anteaters across Brazilian highways, the conservationists building bridges for California's mountain lions, the animal rehabbers caring for Tasmania's car-orphaned wallabies. While crossings is rife with other species, mule deer and capybaras, wombats and monarch butterflies, it also considers how our own lives have been captured by pavement and how we can reclaim them. Wild animals, the naturalist Henry Beston wrote, are neither our brethren nor our underlings. Instead, they are other nations caught with ourselves in the net of life and time. And the road ensnares us both. This book is about how we escape. Part 1. Killer on the Road. 1. And now the devil wagon. How the rise of cars made animal life more perilous, sabotaged evolution, and birthed a new science. If road ecology has a birth date, it's June 13, 1924, the morning a biologist named Dayton Stoner and his ornithologist wife Lillian left their home in Iowa City, bound for a research station 300 miles away. The couple planned to spend the month capturing and banding birds, as they did most summers. That year, their tally would include kingfishers, house wrens, and brown thrashers. Posterity doesn't record their vehicle's make, but it's a decent bet they drove a Model T. For the Stoners, who'd met at the University of Iowa, joint research trips were a chief pleasure of married life. In 1918, 6 years after they wed, they had traveled together on an insect-collecting expedition to Barbados. It was an eventful voyage. Locals concluded that the quiet American with the dark mustache and the butterfly net was a German spy, hurled rocks at him, and threatened to tie him up. The couple, reported a companion, reaped a rich entomological harvest at the peril of their lives. They returned with a haul of tarantulas, locusts, and stink bugs, Mr. Stoner's particular pets, and their partnership reinforced. Dayton and Lillian would publish several papers together, including one on bank swallow chicks and another on an owl sick with bumblefoot. Little wonder, then, that the Stoners didn't get far that June day in 1924 before they found something to investigate. Within minutes of departing Iowa City, they noticed the roadside was strewn with a considerable number of dead animals, apparently casualties from passing motor cars. The first commercial car radio was still 6 years off. A couple had to entertain themselves somehow on a road trip across the Midwest. Dayton and Lillian invented a morbid game to pass the time, an enumeration and actual count of the dead. Over the next 2 days, the Stoners jounced through farmland and woodlots, rarely exceeding 25 miles per hour, noting each victim they passed. It was a perfect activity for Dayton, who, as a colleague noted, was ruled rather strictly by two compulsions, one emanating from his personal reserve, the other from his scientific discipline. I imagine Dayton behind the wheel, Lillian beside him with pencil and pad, the light golden on the corn as they gently squabble. Was that a woodchuck or a rabbit? A catbird or a grackle? All told, they counted 84 animals on their way to the field station and 141 on the drive home. Among them, 19 flickers, 18 ground squirrels, 14 garter snakes, 2 weasels, and a shrike. The Stoners weren't the first to recognize the environmental hazards of transportation. Roadkill predates the automobile. The novelist and poet Thomas Hardy eulogized the animals trampled by horse-drawn war wagons at Waterloo. The moles' tunneled chambers are crushed by wheels, the lark's eggs scattered, their owners fled. And you thought Napoleon had a bad time. Yet roadkill remained absent from the scientific literature until 1925, when Dayton Stoner published his and Lillian's surveys in Science. Their study, a road ecology urtext, diagnosed a malady with no name. The word roadkill was still 2 decades from coinage. Footnote. Roadkill appears to have entered the lexicon in 1943, courtesy of Robert McCabe, an ecologist who observed juvenile partridges being killed by cars. The Oxford English Dictionary's first citation occurs in 1972, in a highway guide that referenced magpies feeding on carrion or roadkills. End footnote. Call it what you will. America's burgeoning need for speed, Stoner claimed, had become one of the important checks upon the natural increase of many forms of life. Stoner's angst didn't arise in a societal vacuum. Like many Americans, he judged the automobile a disruptive and fearsome technology. By the 1920s, cars had claimed tens of thousands of human lives, frayed social contracts, and demoted pedestrians to second-class citizens. Even the widely heralded dirt roads of Iowa are tainted with human blood, Stoner wrote. His roadkill concerns emerged from this broader automotive anxiety. Not only is the mortality among human beings high, he carped, but the death-dealing qualities of the motor car are making serious inroads on our native mammals, birds, and other forms of animal life. Where some perceived progress, the stoners saw threat. That roads threaten animals is ironic, for it was animals who inscribed the first etchings on the palimpsest that is America's road network. Many of our best-used roads began as wildlife trails, often bulldozed by bison, renowned for their sagacious selection of the most sure and direct courses, that solidified into Native American footpaths. Indigenous roads paralleled the Columbia, Colorado, and Mississippi rivers, tracked the Pacific coast from Mexico to Alaska, and breached the Rocky Mountains. Roger Williams, the minister who founded Rhode Island, traveled the Northeast in 1636 via a Pequot and Narragansett trade route, and marveled that native feet had beaten a track in the most stony and rocky places. English travelers on foot and horseback adopted this Pequot path, the most expedient route from Boston to New York, and mail carriers incorporated it in the Boston Post Road, which today comprises portions of U.S. 1, 5, 20, and other traffic-choked highways. When Nathaniel Hawthorne wrote that the native architects of New England's roads were perhaps saddened by a flitting presentiment that the white man's heavy tread will find its way over all the land, he hadn't even anticipated Dunkin' drive-thrus. As colonial roads superimposed themselves atop native trails, they became instruments of empire, the westward grasping tentacles of a rapacious nation. In 1816, when South Carolina Representative John C. Calhoun lobbied Congress to fund new wagon routes, he spared no grandiosity. "Let us then bind the Republic together with a perfect system of roads and canals," Calhoun thundered. "Let us conquer space." His bill was vetoed, but his cause triumphed. Between 1807 and 1880, the U.S. Army carved 21,000 miles of roads through prairies, forests, and mountains, cracking open America's interior to mail delivery and agriculture. Roads became tools of subjugation. When the government strong-armed the Potawatomi into ceding its territory in 1826, federal negotiators insisted the tribe include a 100-foot-wide belt of land, a strip that became the Michigan Road, the main route to Indianapolis. The state of Indiana funded the road's construction by selling off the Potawatomi's dispossessed lands, the ill-gotten gains of imperialism converted to infrastructure. America's early roads were shoddy, only rarely surfaced with gravel or stone, and at constant risk of being reclaimed by nature. In 1755, a British general named Edward Braddock hacked a 12-foot-wide road through the Maryland scrub, a chore so dangerous that three wagon teams tumbled off a cliff in the process. Just 3 years later, Braddock's hard-won road had reverted to a trace through the forest. In the early 19th century, legions of turnpike companies paved toll roads with macadam, stone blocks that locked together beneath the pressure of wheels and horses. By the mid-1800s, though, railroads had usurped horses, and neglected turnpikes devolved into muddy troughs, an era known as the Dark Age of the rural road. Frustrated farmers often abandoned wagons in the mire, a loss they knew as the mud tax. Desperate road builders resorted to whatever materials they had on hand. Engineers in coastal Texas raised oyster beds to pave roads with shells, while officials in Washington promoted an annual straw day, during which wheat growers carpeted boggy tracks with a layer of, yes, straw. In the 1890s, America's deplorable roads were salvaged by a newfangled invention, the modern bicycle. The nation went wild for cycling, which promised freedom and good health. Earlier bikes, with their ludicrously outsized front wheels, had been too dangerous to provide reliable transport. Women pedaled to unchaperoned dates. Ministers deemed cycling the very highest, fullest, and completest physical, mental, and spiritual culture. As cycle mania swept the country, the condition of its roads became an embarrassment. Good Roads, a literally muckraking magazine founded by the League of American Wheelmen, called out lousy roads and lauded ones that had been drained, graded, and paved. Farmers initially distrusted the Eastern bicycle fellers meddling in rural affairs, but soon made common cause. The U.S. government waged a national public relations campaign building high-quality, object lesson roads that showed locals how pleasant their byways could be with a little investment. In 1904, one official crowed that on the road-building front, more has been done in the last decade than during the 100 preceding years. Yet American roads were no match for the next transportation revolution. As the 20th century dawned, automobiles exploded like bacteria in a petri dish. 78,000 registered vehicles in 1905, 2.3 million in 1915, more than 5 million 3 years after that. The only impediments to the horseless carriage's growth were the abysmal surfaces on which they rolled. Slop-spattered French drivers withdrew from American races in disgust. German imports broke down on roads of a kind wholly undreamed of in Europe. By 1909, despite the efforts of the Good Roads Movement, only 8% of America's 2.2 million road miles qualified as improved, a designation that included everything from gravel surfacing to sand and clay mixtures to rudimentary rut filling. The American who buys an automobile finds himself with this great difficulty, sighed one manufacturer. He has nowhere to use it. Into the muddy breach at last stepped an engineer named Thomas MacDonald. Like Dayton Stoner, MacDonald was an Iowan, raised in a town whose rich, damp soils at once produced bountiful crops and prevented farmers from hauling them to market. In college, MacDonald studied the embryonic science of road building, analyzing the efficiency of horse teams on dirt roads versus paved ones. After graduating in 1904, he traveled Iowa extolling the benefits of good roads and ferreting out corrupt contractors. Soon he ascended to the job of state highway engineer. He wasn't a guy with whom you would want to get a beer. Biographers describe him as so painfully formal that his siblings called him Sir. But his discipline and zeal made him the perfect corrective to Iowa's chaotic morass. By 1916, several counties had begun to whip their roads into shape, and the rest, MacDonald predicted, would soon make the gravel fly. All that flying gravel elevated MacDonald's profile, and in 1919, the solemn engineer was appointed chief of the Bureau of Public Roads, the agency that would become the Federal Highway Administration. He inherited a department so embattled that BPR's own staff called it the Bureau of Parallel Ruts. Despite his odd interpersonal style, MacDonald proved an effective lobbyist, extolling good roads in public speeches and smoky clubs, and in 1921 he convinced Congress to sign landmark legislation called the Federal Aid Highway Act. The law gave states funding to improve their highways and rationalized America's disjointed snarl of roads into a coherent system. Cement, brick, and asphalt manufacturers tapped the gusher of contracts, and soon 40,000 highway miles were being improved annually. Road building, once the haphazard production of hooves, feet, and wagon wheels, evolved into a sophisticated discipline. BPR's journals bulged with arcane studies of vibrolithic concretes, bituminous sealants, and the viscosity of asphalt. Mud hadn't been vanquished, but it was in fast retreat. MacDonald's triumph transformed the country's relationship with roads as thoroughly as it molded the land itself. Before his golden age of construction, meteorology and topography limited when and where people could drive. Ungraded dirt roads became mud baths in spring, dust bowls in summer, and tongues of ice in winter. Americans perceived roads as part of the natural environment, as capricious as weather. Organic entities governed by wind and water, as the historian Christopher Wells put it. Good roads, by contrast, mastered their surroundings, transcending geography and climate to permit high-velocity transportation in all seasons. Roads, ever the conqueror, faced down nature and won. As motorized vehicles overran the countryside, they also mustered forces along another front. The city. For centuries, urban streets had been nodes of activity and commerce, as much bazaars as conduits. Yes, they were the province of carriages and electric streetcars, but they were also where kids played ball and shined shoes, where vendors flogged vegetables, where pedestrians loitered and gossiped. So non-threatening were city streets that the Chamber of Commerce in Rome, New York, implored residents not to manicure their nails on the trolley tracks. Cars turned streets into war zones. Early automobiles were death machines, unencumbered by safety features like turn signals and seat belts, piloted by ill-trained drivers, and subject to only rudimentary laws. Tight curves were marked with pictures of skulls and crossbones, or the Grim Reaper. Journalists bemoaned the proliferation of road hogs, speed maniacs, Sunday drivers, juggernauts, and the dreaded flivverboob, the epithet for an inconsiderate motorist. The automobile struck critics as not only dangerous, but depraved. The moment that the foot touches the accelerator and the hand grasps the wheel, chided one reporter, law-abiding citizens become afflicted with the gas rabies. Desperate cities tried to protect their populace. In Detroit, speed limits matched the gait of a walking horse, a clip so plodding that cars stalled out. New York erected rickety towers from which cops manually relayed signals along Fifth Avenue. Other municipalities trialed primitive speed bumps known as Milwaukee mushrooms. None of it helped much. In 1924, vehicles killed 23,600 people, many of them children, a per capita death toll 60% higher than today's rates. The next year, F. Scott Fitzgerald published a novel at whose climax Daisy Buchanan ran down Myrtle Wilson, who mingled her thick, dark blood with the dust. Literature's most famous act of flivverboobery. As the historian Peter Norton recounted in his book Fighting Traffic, the carnage incited a ferocious backlash. Cities seemed to compete over which could stage the most lugubrious anti-car demonstration. Memphis planted black flags at accident sites. Baltimore erected an obelisk inscribed with the names of dead children, while St. Louis built a cherub-festooned monument titled In Memory of Child Life Sacrificed Upon the Altar of Haste and Recklessness. In Pittsburgh, a safety parade included a float depicting a girl crushed between cars. A demonstration in Milwaukee incorporated a trashed automobile on a trailer. Behind the wheel sat Satan himself. This was the world into which road ecology was born, one where cars were both forces of progress and unholy terrors shredding society's fabric. Automobiles were dangerous in part because their physics seemed to melt their operators' brains. Drivers accustomed to stately horses and bicycles were so discombobulated by cars' weight and speed that the American Automobile Association issued a training manual explaining why, when cars flew around a corner, centrifugal force impelled them to flip over or turn turtle. And the car's mass and velocity were even more stupefying to actual turtles. Consider the self-defense tactics of our commonest creatures, which, like stubborn coastal dwellers facing a hurricane, hunker down rather than retreat. Skunks spray, badgers hiss, opossums play possum, porcupines bristle, tortoises withdraw. Armadillos, oddly, jump. Timber rattlesnakes freeze, confident in their venom. For thousands of years, these stand-your-ground strategies fended off coyotes and hawks, but against automobiles, they were worse than useless. Even those animals that did flee were addled by the speed of cars. Many birds depend on a distance rule to decide when to retreat from danger, meaning that they take flight based on how far away a threat is, not how fast it's going. This might be a reliable operating manual when your enemy is a fox skulking through the underbrush, but not when it's a Model T rattling 40 miles per hour down an improved gravel road. Cars hijacked their victims' own biology, subverting evolutionary history and rendering it maladaptive. From the get-go, the car's detractors fretted about its toll on animals. The haunted auto, an illustration that ran on the cover of Puck magazine in 1910, depicted a swarm of creaturely ghosts, geese, pigs, cats, chickens, hounding the motorist who had run them down. Not until the stoners conducted their germinal survey in 1924, however, did scientists attempt to quantify the problem and diagnose its causes. Roadkill is an apt word, for while the vehicle is the weapon, the stoners realized it was the road that determined the casualty rate. The surfaced roads, Dayton observed, permit of greater speed than dirt tracks, giving animals less time to escape. This feature doomed distance rule adherents like red-headed woodpeckers, which, Stoner wrote, cannot quickly acquire a sufficient velocity to escape the oncoming car and so meet their death. Although the stoners followed improved gravel roads for only one-third of their trip, the rest was on dirt, that surface accounted for half the roadkill. The better the road, the bloodier. Roadkill was only the latest in a litany of ecological catastrophes. 19th-century hunters and trappers had mercilessly persecuted bison, beavers, and wading birds for their pelts and plumage. By the early 1900s, extinction, once a heretical impossibility, had become an unavoidable fact. The car posed yet another threat, and scientists took note. At that stage in the still nameless science of road ecology, counting carcasses during a road trip and mailing your notes to a journal, a practice the roadkill historian Gary Knoll called deadlisting, was enough to earn publication. In California, Ernest E. Claybaugh identified 14 car-struck birds, among them coots, red-winged blackbirds, and house sparrows. William Davis spotted 18 dead turtles in Ohio and mourned the colossal tragedies. In Idaho, Kenneth Gordon totted up jackrabbits and ground squirrels and estimated that the carcasses ran very close to 100 per mile. Charles Whittle, in a paper evocatively titled, "And Now the Devil Wagon," tallied woodcocks, finches, and warblers. Verily, the menaces of civilization to bird life move on apace. They multiply, Whittle wailed. While some scientists dabbled in roadkill counts, one eccentric devoted his life to them. In 1927, an itinerant forester named James Raymond Simmons retreated to a cabin in upstate New York to decompress after years of traveling the Northeast. Soon after settling in, Simmons was visited by a friend who'd just spotted a Vesper sparrow trapped in the soft, hot tar of a freshly paved road. The bird had broken free, leaving behind mute evidence in the form of a tiny toenail and tail feather. Simmons, enthralled by the story, concocted a wild plan to salvage at least a part of the wild creatures whose lives were being snuffed out daily along the highways. Simmons established a receiving station in a farmhouse near Albany and declared himself open to roadkill, by mail or hand-delivered. He issued no public announcement and wasn't even sure his operation was legal. Would some of my cooperators possibly undertake to send me skunk specimens, he wondered. And if so, would the postman be likely to react violently to the perfumed packages? From the outset, he was deluged with specimens. One respondent sent in a cedar waxwing, waxed 8 times on the right wing and only 7 on the left. A neighbor handed off a flycatcher. Observers set up satellite substations and exchanged carcasses of their own. A roadkill social network. Over the next decade, Simmons and his volunteers gathered more than 3,000 specimens, many of which he taxidermied and donated to schools and museums. In 1938, he compiled his observations in a charming scattershot book called Feathers and Fur on the Turnpike. Simmons was not the world's most sophisticated scientist, less inclined to statistics than flights of compassionate poetry. A bluebird against pavement reminded him of a vanished sky that cannot return to us, while a panicky weasel scampering between lanes recalled a brown leaf being blown back and forth by gusts of wind. Nonetheless, signals emerged from Simmons's noisy data. In March and April, he wrote, bird roadkill betrayed the arrival of incoming migrants. By July and August, the carnage reached its zenith, a peak Simmons attributed to inexperienced young appearing on the road. Across the board, males died more often than females. Footnote: although Simmons didn't offer an explanation, males of many species occupy larger ranges and cross more roads than females. Male puff adders, for instance, are crushed 10 times more often as they search for companionship during mating season. End footnote. Cottontail rabbits, the most struck mammal, were remarkably stupid in the face of glaring headlights. Still, Simmons mostly refrained from victim blaming, because the true issue, as the stoners had recognized, was speed. Below 35 miles per hour, Simmons claimed, cars seldom struck animals. Accelerate to 45, though, and they kill rapidly. Exceed 60 miles per hour, and you can figure on scoring a kill every 10 miles or less on most of the improved roads. The good roads revolution had transformed cars into super predators. Heavy, impervious, impossibly fast. While Simmons let the carcasses roll in, Dayton and Lillian Stoner, road ecology's power couple, continued to seek them out. The Stoners seemed constitutionally incapable of going anywhere without stopping for dead animals. In 1928, Dayton and Lillian counted the preponderance of creeping and crawling things, mostly snakes, on their way to Florida, and observed the most deaths on Illinois' fine concrete roads. Traveling from Iowa to Albany a few years later, the couple calculated a rate of approximately 0.029 skunks per mile of improved New York road. As the new discipline grew, it creaked beneath the weight of rivalry. In 1935, William Dreyer, an Ohio biologist whose esoteric specialty was the water contents of ants, counted roadkill between the Midwest and Massachusetts. He found carcasses scant and calculated that cars were claiming only 7,350 wild animals each day, around 5% of Stoner's estimate. To the circumspect ant man, Stoner and his ilk were panic mongers who had extrapolated astronomical casualty rates from exceptional cases of destruction. Dreyer also implored his peers to clean up their methods. Rather than noting rabbits and turtles at random, scientists should perform a systematic statistical survey covering several seasons and various localities. Stoner, chastened, toned down his catastrophism and averaged his data with others, including Dreyer's, to generate a more modest figure. At heart, though, he suspected that everyone's research underestimated the true toll. The counts were vexed by frogs and toads, whose bodies were so soft and yielding that little of the animal remains except an inconspicuous splotch of red. Stoner's road ecology career ended in 1941 with a series of bird kill surveys between New York and Iowa. When he died of a heart attack 3 years later, his obituary speculated he had worked himself to death and called his research characteristically thorough and detailed, but unembellished by expressions of feeling. It was a curious way to describe the oeuvre of a man who had declared Iowa's roads tainted with blood. Evidently, Dayton Stoner could be dispassionate about everything but cars. Stoner's death marked the end of road ecology's first era. The moral panic around cars had faded, stamped out by a loose alliance of auto manufacturers that dubbed itself Motordom. To counter bad press, Motordom bought ads in newspapers, cozied up to editors, and defamed any anti-car activist as a wangdoodle of a charlatan. Lobbyists blamed accidents on jaywalkers, a derogatory neologism for a hayseed bumbling about city streets. Footnote: animals, like pedestrians, are often laden with undeserved culpability. How often have you griped about suicidal squirrels and kamikaze deer? Roadkill victim blaming, one sociologist observed, is a common trope in cartoons, which depict flattened animals with a stereotypical stupidity signified by cross eyes, buck teeth, and sticky out tongue, a portrayal that both warrants these deaths and serves in their partial denial. End footnote. As the car became entrenched, animal collisions, like pedestrian deaths, came to seem inevitable. At the outset of Stoner's carcass counting, he'd believed, perhaps naively, that drivers could be persuaded to slow for wildlife. All animals, if given a reasonable time to escape, will cause the hurried motorist little, if any, delay, he wrote. Simmons, too, had initially hoped that heightened awareness and tougher speed limits would reduce the flow of roadkill to his farmhouse, but he soon abandoned his optimism. A safety campaign on behalf of wildlife, he despaired, would be laughed out of court. Road ecology seemed doomed to wither. In the 1950s, though, a new development began to roil America's highways. A long-persecuted species had again begun to flourish in car-dominated suburbs. A large, dangerous animal whose ascent would change road ecology forever. The deer bounded in front of Jerry Chiapata's car at 10:05 p.m. on a May evening in 1961, a tawny streak that hurtled from the brush to slam against the hood. Chiapata wrenched the wheel, and the car keeled sideways through the Michigan night, its interior rent by screams, his wife's, his daughter's, his own. "Something soft rolled against my foot. It was the baby," Chiapata recalled. When at last the car shuddered to a halt, he found that, though the scene reeked of antifreeze and battery acid, his family was unharmed. Even his unrestrained infant had sustained only a bump. Worst off by far was the still-quivering doe, who had been trapped in the grill like a giant moth. The incident gnawed at Chiapetta, a writer for the magazine Field and Stream. No one, he realized, had the faintest idea how many deer were struck by cars or how many people died in those crashes. Chiapetta queried officials in every state and, from their sparse data, concluded that at least 41,000 deer perished each year. "You never can relax your alertness in a deer area any more than you can on a street where children are playing," he lectured. One biologist he interviewed described deer collisions as a real national problem, one that gets worse every day. Today, Chiapetta's crash wouldn't merit mention in a small-town police blotter, let alone a national magazine. White-tailed deer are everywhere. You can't drive through Hastings on Hudson, the New York village where I grew up, without spotting one elegantly devouring a homeowner's hostas. In most northeastern suburbs, deer are as controversial as they are common. Gardeners consider them defoliants as potent as Agent Orange. Dendrologists accuse them of overbrowsing woodlands, and epidemiologists indict them in the spread of Lyme disease. They have an uncanny knack for polarizing communities. I'd wager that no wild animal has provoked half as many acrimonious town hall meetings. Peter Schwederski, Hastings' former mayor, told me he ran for office on a tripartite platform: taxes, development, deer. After he was elected, Schwederski hit a deer himself, incurring $800 in damages. "My children learned a curse word that day," he sighed. Deer preoccupy road ecologists even more than they do suburban mayors. Unlike, say, black bears, deer are so abundant they cause crashes almost constantly. A deer meets a car every 8 minutes in New York State alone. Unlike frogs and turtles, deer are hefty enough to imperil human lives. In 1995, researchers estimated that deer factor in more than 1 million crashes each year, injure 29,000 drivers, and kill more than 200. A more recent estimate roughly doubled those figures to 59,000 injuries and 440 deaths. Cars have made deer North America's most dangerous wild animal, implicated in 3 times more deaths than wasps and bees, 40 times more than snakes, and 400 times more than sharks. As Jerry Chiapetta could attest, though, the deer almost always get the worst of it. Drivers walk away unscathed from 96% of crashes, known in the bloodless verbiage of highway managers as deer-vehicle collisions, or DVCs. Footnote: most deer-related deaths occur when drivers swerve into a tree or traffic. As the state trooper's mantra goes, "Don't veer for deer." End footnote. Because DVCs tend to be minor wrecks compared to rollovers or head-on crashes, they haven't traditionally received much attention from transportation departments. Most DVCs go unreported, and damage calculations are scarcely more reliable than they were in Chiapetta's day. When Bridget Donaldson, a scientist at the Virginia Department of Transportation, analyzed the handwritten notes of the maintenance workers tasked with scraping up carcasses, She discovered that police records captured barely 10% of the state's DVCs. Deer collisions, she calculated, were quietly costing Virginia more than $500 million every year. "We had no idea how bad the situation was," Donaldson told me. Deer collisions are such fixtures of modern life. They've become an inescapable cultural trope, the service ex machina that bounds from the woods to destroy sedans and advance plots. In film, they've been played for thrills, as in The Long Kiss Goodnight, for comedy, as in Tommy Boy, and for horror, as in Get Out. Even The Simpsons have hit a deer, albeit a statue of one. Homer, duh. Lisa, a deer. Marge, a female deer. Yet the DVC, for all its cinematic prevalence, is an oddly contemporary problem. Spend enough time browsing proto-road ecology studies, and you'll notice something curious. They're devoid of deer. When Dayton and Lillian Stoner drove across Iowa in 1924, they registered terrapins, bull snakes, and fox squirrels, but nary a deer. One fellow who drove 77,000 miles around Nebraska in the 1940s recorded a staggering 6,723 dead animals, from sand lizards to sparrowhawks to spotted skunks. None was larger than a snapping turtle. None was a white-tailed deer. What explained this deerlessness? Speed, or its lack, played a role. Even Thomas McDonald's improved gravel roads rarely permitted drivers to run down an animal as fleet as a whitetail. Mostly, though, early road ecologists didn't find road-killed deer for one reason. There weren't deer to kill. For as long as humans have occupied North America, they've depended on deer. For the Cherokee's deer clan, it was the powerful little deer that kept constant protecting watch over his subjects and saw well to it that not one is ever killed in wantonness. Wantonness, alas, followed European colonists like flies. Spanish traders launched the deerskin industry in 16th century Florida. Before long, merchants were exporting 500,000 deerskins annually to become gloves, book bindings, and other paraphernalia. Venison fed Midwestern logging camps. Skins emerged from tanneries as boot linings and aprons. By 1890, hunters and homesteaders had slashed whitetail numbers from 30 million to 300,000, with most of the survivors scattered in southeastern swamps. The whitetail's recovery proved even swifter than its downfall. In the late 1800s, upper-crust sportsmen, having found the religion of conservation, convinced states to suspend hunting. Biologists relocated deer from places that had them to places with none. Regenerating forests proffered tender seedlings. Cougars and wolves had long since been poisoned or gunned down to sanitize the land for livestock. From the islands of cover, where they had survived precariously for nearly a century, one naturalist wrote, deer pushed out in all directions. And what sort of landscape did they push into? Mid-20th century whitetails found succor in a singularly American ecosystem, as endemic to its home country as the outback or Amazon. Suburban sprawl. Humanity's affinity for suburbs long precedes the car. A letter to the king of Persia, inscribed on a tablet in 539 BCE, praised the property as so close to Babylon that we enjoy all the advantages of the city, and yet when we come home, we are away from all that noise and dust. All that was missing was a Whole Foods. But it wasn't until Model Ts began rolling off the line that the burbs became a dominant landform. As cars permitted urbanites to escape cramped tenements for leafy outskirts, once distinct forms of development, metropolis here, farmland there, bled together like watercolors. The mixing accelerated in World War II's aftermath as mass production techniques that had cranked out planes and tanks retooled to build cheap homes. Americans ate at drive-thrus, watched drive-in movies, planned last rites at drive-up funeral parlors. Suburbia's rise supercharged the whitetail's recovery. Deer thrive in edge habitats, transitional zones where delectable meadows bump up against the shelter of forests. and suburbs offered more edges than a corn maze. Edges between subdivisions and weedy lots. Edges between manicured backyards and second-growth oak thickets. Edges between vegetable gardens and baseball fields. When Europeans arrived in North America, between 8 and 20 whitetails occupied each square mile of habitat. Today, many suburbs crawl with 100 or more. For all its gifts, its acute senses of hearing and smell, its leaping prowess, its four-chambered stomach, the whitetail's greatest aptitude was its ability to live cheek to antler with people, to flourish in the rectilinear hash we made of once fluid landscapes. It doesn't take a road ecologist to figure out what happened when unprecedented driving rates met the explosive population growth of a large mammal. National DVCs leapt from around 70,000 in 1963 to nearly 120,000 just 3 years later, a minimum count, observed biologists, because injured deer may die at some distance from the highway and thus elude roadside surveyors. In Wisconsin, deer kills quadrupled in a decade. Even Joseph McCarthy hit a deer, which he presumably suspected of being a communist saboteur. In Pennsylvania, a deery matrix of farms, towns, and forests, the body count skyrocketed from 7,000 to 22,000 in 7 years. Not even air travel was safe. A plane approaching the Hazleton Airport in 1964.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.